Good afternoon. Let me welcome all of you to this afternoon's Professor S. Ramasession Memorial Lecture, and also to welcome our speaker, Dr. Banerjee. This memorial lecture was instituted by the Council a few years ago in honor of Professor S. Ramasession, former director of the Institute. Professor Ramasession was the joint director in the Institute between 1979 and 1981, and then the director between 1981 and 84. He was also an alumnus of the Institute, having obtained his PhD in the physics department, later a member of the faculty in the physics department, and much later the director of the Institute. Professor Ramasession was also one of India's most outstanding material scientists and one of the persons who really developed the field of material science in India. So it's most appropriate that we have one of India's most distinguished materials engineers, Dr. Srikumar Banerjee, to give this afternoon's lecture. Dr. Banerjee is currently the chairman of the Atomic Energy Commission and secretary to the Department of Atomic Energy. He obtained his bachelor's degree in metallurgical engineering from IIT Kharagpur, and immediately after that he joined the Department of Atomic Energy's training school, and he's been a lifelong member of the BARC, and he's risen to head the organization. Professor Banerjee is a material scientist, a very distinguished material scientist with a very large number of recognitions to his name. I'll only mention that he received the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize in Engineering in 1989. He received the MRSI Medal in 1990, the Birla Gold Medal of the Indian Institute of Metals in 1997, and the MRSI Superconductivity and Material Science Prize in 2003. He was also honored with the Padma Shri in 2005, and he has a number, and he is of course a fellow of the Indian National Science Academy, the Indian National Academy of Engineering, and the Indian Academy of Sciences. It's been somewhat difficult to get a date from Dr. Banerjee for this lecture because of his very many commitments, and therefore I must thank him for taking the time off today to come and spend some time at the Institute and to deliver his lecture on the evolution of advanced nuclear reactors. Dr. Banerjee.
Look. Yes. So thank you, Professor Balaram, for giving me this opportunity. I do indeed feel that it's a great honor for me to come and speak, and particularly a lecture which is for commemoration of... I have been associated with this institute in various ways for many years. I've come to this auditorium and spoken also a number of times. But when we say that it is for Professor Ramasession Memorial Lecture, it's something different. I really feel honored. While I was thinking that what is the title to be selected, initially I thought that I'll choose one of the material science kind of a title. Again, on that kind of a topic, I have given lectures in this auditorium earlier. But today, knowing the interest, see, today nuclear energy has come to the forefront for a variety of reasons. Every day in newspaper you read something about nuclear energy. So I thought, let me tell you something about that. There are other reasons also. Just a few minutes back we are sitting together for thinking of a future course of action where we can have some joint program between IISc Bangalore and the Department of Atomic Energy on some issues which are what we call enabling technologies, not just nuclear technology per se, but enabling technologies which have implications in any energy extraction system. So this is yet another reason which I'll try to explain to you, that how those kind of enabling technologies and the development of that is important for a nuclear reactor design. Generally, a design, whether it's an engineering design or a engineering means a mechanical design or a civil design or electrical, you think it's a matter to be done on a drawing board. And the time scale or the man hours scale that you consider for this design is in matter of several man years maximum. But I will try to tell you that what we are talking of when it a design of a reactor, it's a maybe couple of hundred people working for 20 years. So it's that kind of a scale. So that is what I want to communicate to you, that how exactly this evolves. Will it start from here? Or okay, let me go conventionally. So there it is, definitely multidisciplinary, no question about that. And obviously the subject, first subject will be reactor physics, thermal hydraulics, stress analysis, material science and technology, including manufacturing science, control and instrumentation, and then the design validation by large scale experimentation. Now please excuse me and pardon me for giving some very elementary slides, which is maybe important for few, but for most of you, you all know that what exactly is a nuclear fission. That is, you have a nucleus, generally heavy nucleides, and if you have a neutron coming in and it becomes unstable, then it breaks up, and during breaking up, two fragments of the nuclei go out with some additional neutrons go out. So this is what is called the process of fission, breaking up. And that breaking up, typically because of the mass difference, produces energy. And look at the energy level. 1 gram of U-235 gives you 1 megawatt day of energy. Easy to remember. 1 gram of U-235 gives you 1 megawatt day of energy. And the release is the same amount of energy. We need about 3 ton of coal. So the comparison is between 1 gram and 3 ton, but 1 gram of U-235 as a separated 235, not just uranium. So this typically a million times, and that million factor comes from very simple reason. Electronic exchanges, which is all chemical reactions, are in expressed in electron volt, and nuclear processes are expressed in million electron volt. And that is what you are seeing here. That's the only thing. Now this is what happens. Now chain reaction essentially means a neutron comes, breaks it up, and it also, apart from these two large nucleides, which is say maybe half of this, approximately I'm talking of, plus some additional neutrons come out. And one neutron colliding gives you say maybe two, it's not two typical uranium-235 with a thermalized neutron, thermalized means low energy of the order of 0.25 electron volt or so, will give rise to something like 2.3 neutrons on average. So it's some number, but of that order, 2, 2, 2, 2, 3 and things like that. And so it is possible for it to multiply. That is one giving to two fissions, two can give it to 4, 4 to 8. And if this happens, then you have a nuclear explosion. And if you can control it, if you can have just a chain reaction, that is one neutron comes, breaks up one nucleide, the out of two, one you somehow capture, the one goes on and continues this process, and you establish the chain reaction in a steady state manner, then you will be tapping energy without having an explosion possibility. That is what you are doing here. You can see that somehow to kill these neutrons, and that is the absorbed neutron. So whole purpose of a nuclear reactor design is this, that where you have to balance, and this kind of balance has to be done globally. This also has to be done very, very locally, because otherwise in a very small microscopic volume also there can be excessive temperature rise. So one has to manage this, and that is what is the job of the reactor physicist. Let me tell you another very important thing, that in nature has provided us only one fissionable nucleide, that is uranium-235. But nature has also provided us some fertile material like thorium-232 and uranium-238. A capture of one neutron makes it uranium-239, and then by two beta decays, you get a plutonium-239, which is again fissile. So apart from uranium-235, which is available in nature, there are two other possibilities of fissionable nuclei. One is plutonium-239, the other one is uranium-233. This comes out from U-238, which is in the nature. This comes out from thorium-232, which is also in nature. Now, natural uranium consists of 0.7% uranium-235 and 99.3% this. And thorium is mostly thorium-232. So these are two other resources which we call fertile. So you can also use this. If we take only uranium-235 as a resource, then the story of nuclear energy will not be very long. Typically, it will be for this century. Beyond that, there will be no U-235 left. So if you take uranium-238 and thorium-232 is a part of the story, then the energy can be supplied for maybe several hundred years. So in our country, we have very limited resource of uranium and we have a large resource of thorium. And that has determined the course of the activity in our country. So nature has given uranium and thorium this fertile material. U-235 can be directly used as a fissile. Uranium-238 and thorium-232 can be converted to plutonium-239 and uranium-233, from where again we can get the fissile energy. Now, what is a reactor physicist's job? I don't want to write many equations, just one or two will come perhaps. The issue is that you have to see a steady state situation. For a steady state situation, take a microscopic volume in the whole reactor, huge reactor, even if you take a microscope, in that microscopic volume, you have to see that the rate of change of neutron flux, you just count the neutrons there, and that rate should be, it's a very logical statement that you have a production rate, there will be certain number of leaks and some are absorption rate. And you will see that there are different cross sections. Cross sections is nothing but probabilities of some events happening. So there will be scattering cross section because it is something like slowing down. Again, I can tell you that neutron coming out from a fission process is with a very high energy. It's several 2 to 3 MeV energy. With those neutrons, there'll be some amount of fast fission. But to make that fission more probable, you have to slow down the energy of the neutrons, and that is normally done by the moderator. So here, the calculation actually is for a given energy band, because the cross sections, that is probability of these processes, are very strongly dependent on the energy. So you can see that how many of those neutrons degrade from high energy to the low energy, and that number is counted. How many get absorbed, how many get diffused out. And that difference is nothing but the rate of change of neutron flux, and in case of making it self-sustaining, you have to make this term zero. So that is the whole job. And this has to be fitted everywhere. So essentially, it is not like a curve fitting. The radial flux is in a Bessel function, and axial is a cosine function of this nature. Now coming to the criticality, in a simple way, if I take, this is also very important for devising a nuclear explosive device. If you have a ball of, say, uranium-235, that ball of uranium-235, and you have, there are some spontaneous fission, some neutron can come out, that's not an issue. But if you trigger a fission process, then the question comes that how many neutrons get multiplied within that. So depending on the surface, because escaping from that ball will be depending on how much is the surface. So now the question is, for criticality, it's a simple ball of few kg will become critical. If you can just make a plutonium of even 5 kg ball, it will immediately become an explosive device. So you can't even manufacture something 5 kg. So you have to essentially manufacture in smaller and smaller quantity, but if you somehow melt them together to make a 5 kg ball, immediately it will explode. By the time you are making it, it will be exploding. And that's because of this, because you have a factor, there is average number of neutrons liberated directly by fission for every thermal neutron absorbed in the fuel. That is this number. Second is the ratio of the total number of fast neutrons slowing down past a first fission threshold. P is the fraction of the neutrons that are slowing down that escape the resonance capture. As it comes down, degrades in energy, there are some peaks. I'll show you in a picture later where they can get absorbed, and that's called resonance capture. And finally, the ratio of the thermal neutrons absorbed in the fuel to the number of total thermal neutrons absorbed. So So this number k infinity, if I have an infinitely large volume of material which is filled up with fission material, then in infinite space this will be the factor which has to be become 1 to have a chain reaction established in infinite size, because you are talking no leakage. If you have no leakage, means the volume of that is infinite. Alternatively, you can talk of a k effective, where we have a k infinity, this k infinity modulated by a p factor, which is the p is nothing but the non-leakage probability. So this number again, if you can make k effective is equal to 1, you sustain a chain reaction. So that is the very fundamental of designing a reactor. What are the different components in a reactor? We obviously need fuel, because you need this fissionable substance, that is uranium, plutonium or thorium base fuel. Thorium itself is not fissible, but thorium to uranium 233 will become fissionable. Coolant. If you have energy coming out from some substance, you have to take out that heat, so you need a coolant. Normally coolant is used in such a manner that they don't absorb too much of neutrons. If they themselves absorb neutron, you can consider that that coolant is not so efficient. It has to just take out the heat. You can take out by light water, heavy water, molten sodium, lead, molten lead or alloys. Moderator is something which will, by scattering process, will slow down the energy of the neutrons. Now neutron has a mass number 1, so for effective, you by slowing down is a process which you can visualize as a kind of a scattering process, where it is elastic scattering, and the maximum amount of momentum transfer will be there if the two balls have more or less the same mass. So a neutron will be slowed down best by a hydrogen or a proton particle or hydrogen particle, or it could be larger one like deuterium, but light elements. That's why you'll find that light water, heavy water, graphite, which is also light, or beryllium, they are the suitable moderator. Reflectors are those which again, if you have the reflector around the reactor, they will allow the neutrons to be pushed back into the reactor system and not allow them to leak out. So reflectors are again light water, they are also scattering media, heavy water, graphite or beryllium. Control devices, which will absorb the neutrons much more, and they can be those which have very strong absorption cross section, but of course no efficient cross section, like boron based materials, cadmium based materials and such things, gadolinium. Some of these are even what is called burnable control material. They'll burn off with time, because the new isotope which is created by absorbing, they are no longer absorbing neutrons. So then again, reactor can be conceived that I have a mixture or a solution of all these materials, fissionable material, the coolant, the moderator, everything mixed together, and that's like this. Alternatively, you can have some kind of a tubes in which you have material which are fissionable material put inside, and you have a coolant passing through that, and you have a moderator inside. So this is the heterogeneous reactor. Often you find a homogeneous reactor, like if I take natural uranium. Whichever way you take natural uranium, you make a homogeneous stuff, it will never become critical. So it's not possible to make a natural uranium reactor critical. But if you take natural uranium, just like in case in India, we are doing with heavy water reactors, and put them in heterogeneous configuration, you can actually achieve that criticality at every element and generate this fission in a continuous process. Now in the newspaper, you must be reading about these various types of reactors. These are light water reactors, PWR and BWR. The Fukushima one is a BWR, boiling water reactor. What's the difference between them? In PWR, this one, you find that light water is the coolant. Normally, light water coolant essentially means that enriched uranium has to be the fuel. It is kept pressurized that it is not allowed to boil. Steam is generated in the secondary side, and it's a vessel type of reactor. So this is the reactor pressure vessel. This is the reactor pressure vessel. Inside that, this is the core where the real stuff is there, fuel is there, and it is heating up water, but it's all I would consider liquid, but there's no boiling. And that goes to a steam generator. This is a steam generator. Then steam comes out, and that steam goes into the turbine. After that runs the generator. This is how those circuits are closed. In case of a boiling water reactor, there's a difference, because what they're doing, there's no steam generator. You have a pressure vessel. Inside that, this is the core where the fuel is located, and the water gets heated up, it boils, and that there is a separator inside the reactor pressure vessel, and the steam then goes out, and that steam directly goes into the turbine. You see, this difference is very important. Here you don't have a steam generator. If you have a steam generator, you can have a circuit in which you can cool down in that steam generator and pump it back there, which was not available in Fukushima. So this is one of the problem, but you know, technically it is so good because it's a load following characteristics. This turbine, or you need more load, you are getting suddenly a very high load, it will have a load following character. Immediately the turbine will ask for more steam automatically, and more steam will be generated. One important point to remember is the reactor power depends, I mean, reactor power, is it defined by how much of nuclear inventory you have inside, how much of fissionable substance you have inside? It is not so. The same material can make a nuclear bomb. So it's a tremendous power potential. It is, the power is decided by how much of heat you can extract out. What is the rate at which you can extract out the heat? That is what determines the power of a reactor. Now, this is pressurized heavy water reactor, what we have. So when we are talking of heavy water, why do you use heavy water? Because natural uranium will be something where to make it critical, you cannot afford to have the natural water which has a much larger absorption cross section. Heavy water, that is deuterium oxide, has a much lower absorption cross section, but not as good a moderating efficiency, but it's a good moderator. And so it's a big tank. Imagine this color, which is some kind of olive green color, is a huge tank, horizontal tank, and that tank is filled up with heavy water. And that is one system. In that we have some pressure tubes running. And within the pressure tubes you have fuel bundles which are lined up. And then each of these fuel, this pressure tube, so pressure boundary are many. There are some nearly 340 to 400 number tubes which are running through like this. And this is the part, the steam, there's no steam, the heavy water is a coolant. The heavy water carries that, takes it to the steam generator, and then that steam goes out. In a way similar to pressurized water reactor, but you are using here heavy water instead of a natural water for the coolant. Now come to the different fuel cycles. So we hear about the different fuel cycles. You mine uranium, it can be chemically processed for refining either uranium or thorium. Then it goes to the making, as I was telling you, the bundles, these are the fuel bundles. All these are made in nuclear fuel complex at Hyderabad. From there it goes to the reactor and you get power, and after that the spent fuel is taken out, and this spent fuel, from there you can get plutonium. And then finally the waste goes to the waste management, and this waste management, I'll come to that in a moment. If you process, you get plutonium. This is a reprocessing plant, and that plutonium can again be used for making fuel, which again can be sent back to the reactor. So this is called a closed fuel cycle. Now in some countries, particularly in the USA, they don't believe in the closed fuel cycle, because their consideration is that if you are handling plutonium being so dangerous, and also plutonium being a major constituent for making nuclear bombs, so it's better not to avoid, just don't do anything on plutonium. You do like this and finally make the waste and put it into the earth, not in a careless manner, but in a deep underground geological repository, where it is engineered facility, deep inside, in a very stable geological repository. Either it could be granitic or it could be clay, and there you can keep it in an engineered condition for many years. But it will require waste management. That waste management, essentially, that the waste material is converted into a glassy form, an amorphous form, because that amorphous glassy material is stable against any kind of corrosion, and it is stable against any leaching. So then you can encase it and can have stored inside the earth, where you can have this deep geological repository. In our country, since we are doing most of it by this circulation, by the closed fuel cycle, the quantum of the waste that we generate is much, much smaller. And that we convert into the glassy form, and we still don't have any geological repository in the country. What we are doing, we are keeping it in large size engineered halls. You can see this hall, and I don't think you will be able to see well, but there are some tile holes, and these are the robotic arrangement where it is placed inside a huge chamber underground, which is again which is continuously being cooled, by air cooling, and then you can keep it for years, but not really centuries. This is only an interim arrangement for keeping the waste of a very large, it was rather small volume. And once we have a program very large, then this will develop into a large quantity, and we have to think of many opportunities. One of them, of course, is by geological repository, where the most modern and most promising thing is that if you use it in a accelerator and reduce the radioactive life of this waste from 10,000 years to something like 200 years. It's possible. Now, Indian resources, today we can say about 150,000 ton of uranium we have in the country. But all that is mineable, that I cannot say, because there are many factors. There are many factors which are to be considered. There may be a geopolitical factor, there could be social factor, there could be environmental factor, for which everything is not really mineable. We have a fairly large amount of thorium in the beach of Kerala and Orissa, which will have thorium. So you can see, because we have such a large quantity of thorium, it is quite possible that we can really extend it. And this is thorium here, this is the total uranium, not 235. Whereas this thorium is all convertible to uranium-233, it's a huge inventory. So Indian approach is that in the first stage we'll be converting uranium, we'll be using energy from U-235 by direct fission, and at the same time convert uranium-238 and thorium-232 to plutonium and uranium-233, and then they can be used in the subsequent generation reactors, either in the fast reactor when we are burning plutonium-239 or uranium-233 in the third stage reactors. The first stage program is, I've just listed it here, and you can see that we have we had some choices, and the choice of the fuel was natural uranium. When the program started in 60s, we didn't have the capability of enriching uranium, and we wanted to have the program completely self-sufficient, so we didn't depend on imported uranium, and we did it mostly with natural uranium, excepting for Tarapur 1 and 2, which are two imported reactors. Today we run 20 reactors, 18 of them are pressurized heavy water reactor, indigenous, and two of them, as I mentioned, the first two, which came in 1966, commissioned in 69, they were Tarapur 1, 2, which are boiling water reactor. Incidentally, they are similar to the Fukushima, but there are some differences also. Now, the whole rationale of the three phase is actually given here. It's a very simple reactor physics plot. You see, this is the neutron energy. If you are running a reactor when the energy is in this level, you can see 0.1 EV to EV, then we call it a thermal reactor. If the energy is in this level, 1 MeV, then we call it a fast reactor. And in between, we have epithermal possibilities. Now, look at, what is this number? This is a number of neutrons per neutrons absorbed. And that number, as I mentioned earlier, that will be around 2, it is around 2. But in case of plutonium-239, which is indicated by the dashed line, the numbers in the 1 MeV range close to goes to 3. The 3 is very significant. One neutron you require for carrying on the chain reaction process. Second neutron you require, which can convert, say, either uranium-238 to plutonium or thorium-232 to uranium-233. So that can actually substitute whatever you have lost by the fission process. You can gain one such fissionable nucleide by that process. And you still have one extra neutron left. And that neutron can give you even more fuel than what you are really spending. That is why if you run fast reactor using plutonium, you can actually generate more fuel than what you have converted, than what you have actually used. But it is not for nothing. From the fertile material, you are getting that much of extra fissile. So you spend some fissile, but you generate fissile material more than what you have actually used. So that's the advantage of running fast reactor in that domain of fast neutron with plutonium-239. And there are other features, particularly if you look at uranium-233 plot, which gives you, this is what is called the resonance absorption here. So you can see this is a fluctuating one. But the red line is for the uranium-233. And that has more or less a flat nature, which essentially means that thorium or uranium-233 based fuel burns equally well from thermal energy right up to the first energy. So when you talk of what will be our third stage reactor, how would it look like, we can't really say today. It could be a thermal reactor, it could as well be a fast reactor. Because in entire range of energy, it will burn very well. So coming to the second stage, we have the fast reactor. I think I am going very slow, so I have to fast. So question is that the second stage is by the fast reactor, which I have just explained. I don't want to spend time there. And this is a slide which we have used so many times. This is the first phase where we are using with our indigenous uranium. We can have a program of something like which will produce 300 gigawatt electric year. 300 gigawatt electric year essentially means if you have 10,000 megawatt capacity, that will run for 30 years. That's all. So the whole program will be limited to only this with the indigenous uranium. But the moment we take that plutonium into account, which comes out from this, and burn it in the fast reactor, you see the energy potential goes by several factors. From 300 gigawatt electrical, it goes to 42,000 gigawatt electrical. And if we again multiply by converting thorium to uranium-233, then we get a total energy potential of 155,000 gigawatt electrical year. And once we are in that position, then we will be able to provide energy for really several centuries, and we can be an energy sufficient country. So where we are, as I mentioned, 20 reactors operating. We have been running a fast reactor for last 25 years. A 500 megawatt prototype fast breeder reactor in Kalpakkam is very near completion. And we have made a first, it's just a kilowatt thermal, very small Kamini reactor operating, and a 300 megawatt electrical advanced heavy water reactor is designed. But this is not truly a third stage. It is only a demonstration, a kind of an advanced demonstration of some of the technologies. So the technological requirements, we have to talk of uranium-233, and which has some problems also. Uranium-233 is always having some amount of uranium-232. And this small amount, something like 1000 ppm, is also very dangerous, because uranium-232 has gamma active isotopes, daughter products. So when you talk of uranium, if you go to say nuclear fuel complex in Hyderabad, you will find that the operation is being done in a conventional engineering industry. If you talk of plutonium, plutonium cannot be handled like that. Plutonium has to be handled necessarily in the glove box, because it emits alpha particles. So glove box is something where alpha will be all protected. When it comes to gamma emitting isotope, neither you can do it in, you have to go for hot cells. So the entire industry has to be done in the hot cell. So that is why when the moment we talk of uranium-233, handling that is not a trivial job. And there are other issues. Of course, there are ways of cleaning up and all that, which you are working on. So this kind of a thing has to be, the fuel cycle has to be developed. And many of these technologies are quite new, and developing them would require a utilization of these technologies on a large scale. So that is why we are working for some reactors which will give us the confidence of building this third stage reactor. And I'm talking of that as the novel reactor or a new reactor for which the design effort is going on for years. Now, pressurized heavy water reactor, it looks like that, the face of a pressurized heavy water reactor like that. You can see this is a reactor face, which is showing each of these, it's looking at that lattice, each of these are the pressure tube through which goes the bundle of uranium oxide, and that is being cooled by the heavy water. And that heavy water passage is through these pipes. All these pipes are high pressure pipes, 1500 psi pressure inside, temperature around 300 degrees Celsius, carries the heat out from the fuel and finally goes to the steam generator. So look at the maze of the pipe structure, and I don't have a picture of it. Some typically a man height will be something like this. So it's a huge mammoth thing, and this is a huge robo which has to connect with this pressure tubes or end fittings, and from there it can take out the fuel, shuffle it and put it back. So it's rather non-trivial process. But that's what has to be done every day, because it's an onload fueling system. Here, you don't stop the reactor for refueling. Continuously, every day, 2-3 times, you break the pressure boundary and exchange the fuels. This is the on-power fueling. But in a purely from physics angle, this is one of the best design, excellent physics design. With minimum amount of neutron loss, you are doing that work. It's the best use of uranium. Very complex engineering, very careful choice of the core material. But the neutrons, you see, in resources, if you term, one side resource is your fissionable material. The other very important resource is neutrons. Neutrons cannot be allowed to lose. Because neutrons you can't generate otherwise. It's only coming as a product of a fission process. So we consider that is very important, and this system is something which is best for the neutron economy. And another thing is that though this large tank is the calendria tank, but it's not a high pressure tank. So here you don't have to make a huge high pressure RPV, reactor pressure vessel. And reactor pressure vessel making a large size, 1000 megawatt reactor pressure vessel, even today India does not have the facility. Only recently we have signed one MOU where with Larsen & Toubro and NPCIL that they will build this large size reactor pressure vessel in Hazira in Gujarat. So we know about PHWR, we have built so many. Now when you think of a new innovative design, we start from this PHWR to HWR. What are the design improvements? We know PHWR has a high neutron economy, very good fuel utilization, moderator is a heat sink. Moderator is a huge tank of water. Again, bringing back the Fukushima, because everybody knows about Fukushima so well, that one of the biggest issue in nuclear reactor is that where is the inventory of coolant? Where is the inventory of huge quantity of water is required? In case of any excursion, thermal excursion, I'm not talking of accidents, you need that huge resource of water or coolant. So here, the moderator itself is a huge heat sink. But some of the undesirable features are positive void reactivity coefficient. Let me explain in a little bit what is that positive void reactivity coefficient. You are taking out heat by coolant water. Let us take that as at some place you have a small boiling, a bubble forms. The moment there is a bubble formation, there is a lack of coolant because that bubble will be a barrier for heat transfer. Immediately there will be temperature rise, and corresponding to temperature rise, whether the reactivity, whether that area will have a higher fission probability or lower fission probability. Actually fission probability will go up because you are actually having less moderation there, and that is the problem in this reactor. This is one of the weakness of the PHWR. Low discharge burn up, because you are starting with 0.7% uranium-235. So typically 1% corresponds to 10,000 megawatt day. But if it is 0.7%, you will get 7000 megawatt day total energy that will come out. It's a low discharge. In typical case of a LWR, light water reactor, this number will go to 40,000 megawatt. Today we are working even higher. In our fast reactor, we have gone up to even 150,000 megawatt day. Tritium problem. Heavy water is good, but heavy water means deuterium. Deuterium, if it absorbs one neutron, what will be? It will be tritium. And that tritium, you have seen the picture of piping. In all that pipe, tritium will go to an extent, and that will have a tritium activity which will be larger than the background activity inside the reactor hall. I'm not talking of outside. In case of PHWR, will be little higher than what you expect in a light water reactor. So these are some deficiencies. So if you think of a new design, is it possible that we can avoid this and have a design where these things will not be there? So that is how the evolution came. The question came and said there's the design attributes, the technology of the tube type. We have been developing, we have worked on the tube type reactor technology for all these years. So this is one point. Facilities to build large reactor pressure vessel, not yet available. It will be available very soon. Replaceable coolant channels. Those coolant channels which I just shown you, they are also not something which will last the lifetime of the reactor. They need to be replaced. They need to be replaced. Earlier it was zircaloy 2, which we are getting replaced after 8 full power year of operation. Today we are having zirconium niobium, which may go beyond 15 to 20 years, and that's what we are using now. But it is still to be replaced because the reactor life is 40 years. In fact, today we are talking of a reactor life which is 100 years. Heavy water as a moderator. Now we want, these are our sort of ambition. We start with some ambition, we'll design something. It will be thorium using thorium. So conversion of thorium to uranium-233 in the initial stage. Maximize the energy of uranium-233 burning in equilibrium core. Online refueling, passive systems such as natural circulation for heat removal during normal operating and shutdown conditions. This is a very important point. Now let us take that if we have a reactor where the coolant is passed by a pump, pump requires electricity. If we have a reactor where there's no pump, it will naturally flow, then that is called a passive system. And the light water coolant, that problem of tritium in the LSR will not be there, and negative void coefficients. So these are our objectives, design objectives or design ambitions. Passive system is either a system which is composed of passive components and structures of a system which uses active components in a very limited way to initiate subsequent process. That is, it does not require any motive force. No electricity is required, no signal is required. In a complete plant blackout condition, even then the cooling will be continued without any disturbance. No human intervention is also required. In fact, there is something interesting that this kind of development has been going on for years, and personally also I never realized that what is the importance of this. But today you know that we really have to work for systems which are 100% passive. There's no question, you cannot take credit of anything. You have to think that you are in complete isolation, there's no human intervention, there's no water supply from outside, there's no electric power coming. In spite of that, is it possible to cool down the reactor? So that's one of the very important design objective, and this was chosen long, long time back, and work has gone, and we have a system which matches this. So this is what I have just described. Again, there also to see that what are the possibilities of even passive systems, reliability is an issue, and that has to be seen. Now I'll explain to you that what do you mean by this? Is it possible to do that? If you have a source of heat, just imagine a loop, a source of heat is there and you have a heat sink here. Just by gravity, because the hot water or water plus steam is lighter than water, so it will raise up automatically. It will go into that, you take out that heat, it will cool down, it will come into this. So if I have just a heat source and a sink like this, it is possible to make water flow like that. But the prime mover, the moving force is not very large. So that is where you have to see that the path has minimum restraint so that it can move very easily. And then there are many challenges. Here is a very simple circuit. If you have a circuit in which there are multiple parallel flow possibility, then all these issues are to be seen. So the rationale for developing this specification is that how the reactivity changes in response to a change in the value of a parameter, that is the reactivity coefficient and negative void coefficient. We have to have something that if there's a slight heating up, immediately that area nuclear fission probability has to be reduced. So that's one condition. The other coefficients are fuel temperature coefficient. These are some details, I'll not go into that. So we have to have a thorium based fuel, heavy water moderated, light water cooled, vertical pressure tube. The moment earlier I showed that the pressure tubes are like this horizontal. So there's in horizontal tube, how do you use the passive cooling? Impossible. You need the gravity flow. So you have to make them vertical. Boiling in the core and low power, just a 300 megawatt, but the reactor size will be huge, and passive safety systems. There is no limit to the power, I just mentioned to you. It is only the heat removal rate which determines the power of a reactor. And there's a strong coupling between the two things. One side is the thermal hydraulics, temperature change in the whole core, and the other side is the neutronics, because you have to continuously see that every small elemental volume of the entire reactor core, the criticality condition is satisfied. So these two coupling are very strong, and that is also very sometimes not so good, because if there is a temperature rise and correspondingly reactivity goes up, then there will be negative thing. But if you have a negative feedback situation, the moment there is a heating up, correspondingly the fission probability has to come down. There are many evolution. One evolution, as I told you, that heat source, this is a reactor, and here is a steam drum, and here is a secondary steam generator. So one evolution process was this. Then if you take this, the secondary steam generator, if you remove that, then this is the first step of the evolution in the design. Second step is that the outer header is removed, then to eliminate the potential source of stratification. Wherever you have water and steam, there's a possibility of stratification. And stratification, as you know, is not something which is favorable or conducive for the flow of water. So stratification to be avoided. So that eliminated the outer header. Then the separator is removed, steam drum to reduce hydraulic resistance. The whole path you have to reduce that. And that is what the next step of evolution. Next step of evolution is the loop height. This loop height from this, it has made into higher because you get that much of advantage of the gravity. The next is the core height. This is the core height. You actually reduce the core height and increase the diameter. That's also, so each of these steps are essentially design evolutions. And for each of these, you have to work out the entire thermal hydraulics, neutronics, stress analysis, and everything. So that is how you finally arrive at a kind of a configuration on the very basic of a nuclear reactor. This is a reactor, it's a steam drum, and that is how the heat will be And there's no pump. In the whole thing, you see there's no pump. Come to the reactor core physics design. So first was what is called a seed blanket concept. You have a seed where you have plutonium. See, when you are using thorium, thorium itself will not burn. Thorium has to be converted into uranium-233. So that is called the blanket. All these red circles are the blanket material. The green ones are the plutonium, the driver fuel. So it will not only be generating energy, but those neutrons which are coming out from here will actually convert these thorium channels into uranium-233. And by reprocessing, again you can go back. So initially we started working for a seed blanket concept. This is a very tight neutronic thermohydraulic coupling, which is again from the safety angle not so good. Difficult to maintain the same coolant condition in seed and blanket. There is a very large difference between the cooling condition in this locality and in this locality, and uneven distribution of coolant clusters of different dimensions. So these are the problems. We went to the uniform core concept. Finally, a design, complete design is now available, and we know that it's AHWR is a vertical pressure tube type, boiling light water cooled and heavy water moderated reactor using uranium-233 with thorium MOX. MOX means mixed oxide, and plutonium thorium MOX. These are some parameters which we have finally come up to for the. Now there is a very strong, the reactor physics has to work out many things. One of the issues is that what is called peaking. The flux, you have a configuration. The fuel is not a very simple design. Fuel, we thought of different possibilities. One possibility is typically a bundle of fuel is like that. Each of these, you can see this is thorium uranium-233 MOX, and here we have thorium plutonium MOX. Or it could be this, or finally it has come up to this. 54 pin circular pitch with a zircaloy to central displacer. There's a water rod, it's called this one, the blue one is a water. Now, in this, what we are actually trying to achieve? We are trying to achieve that if you look at the neutron flux, so for each of them, for this one, you find the neutron flux distribution is like, there's a very strong peaking at the periphery and there's a depression of flux at the middle. This one, you see, after all that calculation, what we have arrived at, the radial peaking factor is of the order of 1.18. So something like 18% variation is the maximum variation that will be there in the radial direction. So this is an optimized the neutron the flux peaking plot. Now, out of all this, what we have achieved now, the 65% power from thorium, several passive features. These several passive features, you say one word, is a 3 days grace period. What do you mean by grace period? In case of this nuclear plant getting totally isolated from the rest of the world, no water, no electricity, no human intervention, it will cool down for 3 days without any difficulty. That much of inventory of water inside, that much of possibility of cooling down is already available. Passive shutdown system. Shutdown system also is not depending on any mechanical or electromechanical devices which requires the external force. Design life is 100 years. The coolant channel, as I mentioned, are easily replaceable. Today it is not so easily replaceable. It is possible, we have been doing it, but this is also yet another feature. Now, to what extent, because there is always a question that we have been talking of thorium for years, what really we have done so far? This what so far done is individual technology development. So it's a question of thorium extraction, that has been done. Use of thoria in pressurized heavy water reactor, it has been done quite extensively. Dismantling of those, and then these are the hot cells where we are processing and getting uranium-233 out of it, that also has been done. Using that uranium-233, we are running a research reactor, and we have made a advanced heavy water reactor critical facility where we can test this kind of fuel. These are all done as a technology enabler. And here is the circuit. So the passive core cooling by natural circulation, passive decay heat removal. Now, the concept of this decay heat removal is very important, because if you shut down a reactor, again bring the Fukushima example, the moment you shut down, when the earthquake or the seismic wave arrived, the plant immediately it responded, all reactors were shut down. Then if reactor is shut down, where is the problem of cooling? Cooling comes is that if the reactor is operating at 100 megawatt, immediately after shutting down, within first 1 hour, the power will come down to 5%, 5 megawatt. So 5 megawatt power is still coming out. Now 1 hour there's no problem, but by that time came the tsunami wave. So it flooded all the pumps, all the secondary or tertiary power supplies. So no power availability, no water availability. So once that happens, but still you are having say 5% of the power coming after 1 hour. Within few hours, it 5% it goes down to 1 hour. But even then, that 1 hour, 1% power is a power. That much of energy is coming out, but you don't have any coolant to take that heat out. That is called a decay heat. This decay heat comes not from the fission process. Decay heat comes out from the decay of the radioactive decay of the products, radioactive products which are there inside the reactor core. So decay heat removal is a very critical factor in reactor design. So that decay heat removal also has to be done in a passive manner. Shutdown system is also passive. Emergency core cooling system, injection by accumulators and gravity driven water pool. The emergency core cooling also need to be done in a passive manner without any pump. And finally, the containment, these are the double containment system. You can see double line. These are huge concrete vaults in which it is there, but even that will get heated up and you have to continuously cool it. So that also has to be done in a passive manner. How this is done is shown in these loops. The reactor core is only this much. In fact, if you look at this picture, the reactor volume is like this, but actual reactor core is so small. The actual place where the nuclear fission is occurring is actually a very small area in the whole reactor building. And that is what is being shown here. And as I showed you that this is the steam drum, so generally the heat is coming out and you are taking out like this. Now as the pressure changes, this is at the typically the steam drum, and there are several steam drums, and now you see that pressure is 70 bar. From that you are taking out heat by an external loop, and from there you are again going to the turbine. Now if the pressure increases, suddenly pressure goes to 71 bar. So you have to have a different way of taking out heat, and that is what is being shown here. Then it goes to still higher pressure, because higher pressure means higher energy content, higher enthalpy. So with that, immediately you find that isolation condenser, they start cooling down the steam drum. From here heat is coming to the steam drum. Steam drum heat also has to be taken out, and that is being done by this isolation condenser. Beyond that, if it happens, you see that helium pressure poison is something which is like a control material but dissolved. Poison is something which will be kill the neutrons. So poisons are injected directly into this. But this also, you have a pressurized helium cylinder. So again, you don't need any active component. It will pump in the liquid poison inside that. So reactor will be completely shut down. So if you do this kind of a multi-tier safety systems, then you can see that the clad surface temperature, this is the peak clad temperature changes with a complete station blackout. With a complete station blackout, you'll find there'll be a small peak of the temperature rise. You can see the temperature here. It's in Kelvin. It just shows a peak and then it flattens up, and for long, long time. So these major challenges are all set by the design. Now you may say that this design is done in the paper. Who believes that design? You have many, many equations you have assumed, many cross sections you have taken into account. How will I have a trust on that design? I'll come to that point. So there are, but when you think of a design, you have to see the multitude of the problem. It is not just one thing: heat, neutron flux, stressing of the system, all simultaneously have to satisfy your requirement. And that is how the design is done. So the control of the natural circulation flow instability, question of instability comes. One very interesting thing. You have parallel channels. Who says that if I have parallel channels, why not one channel draws more water, the other becomes dry? It can happen. So the question comes that will the parallel channel take the water in the same rate or within a band? What is that? So this question will come. There are issues of critical heat flux limits. Everywhere you have to see whether we are exceeding the critical heat flux limit. The moment we exceed, there will be a local problem, local melting. Startup procedure, how to start up this issue? Avoid the stratification in large pools, development of passive valves. Then valves also has to be passive. If you say I have valves which are operated by electromagnetic force, they will not be operating if you don't have electricity. Similarly, passive containment isolation system. So each of these have been addressed. So passive safety features, I think I have to really jump. I'll come back to that if you have questions. gravity driven water pool. Can you imagine 8,000 cubic meter of water is there? It's much larger than a swimming pool inside the building. And that store is there so that you can take out heat for a 3-day period. And the moment you put a water pool on top of the reactor, there are other issues. You have to now think of, in a seismic condition, how this water is going to behave. Sloshing is a very important thing. The water will also move in form of a, and that sloshing, will it cause any damage to the building? Will that, you may not have any problem due to neutron processes, but you may get immersed in water. There's so much water up. So you have to see that, how to do that in the different seismic conditions. All these are taken into account. Then comes the containment building. What are the different factors? You take into factor like flooding. Flooding by some kind of a very incessant rain. It could be by flooding due to nearby dam. This is one of the things which can happen in India. It's taken into account. Flood loads, what will be the flood load correspondingly? Earthquake. You take into tsunami. You take into aircraft impact. That's also is another factor taken into account today. So you design the containment. So when you talk of this kind of a design, I don't know whether any civil engineers are sitting here. You have to take into account not the static load, but you have to take the static and dynamic load resulting from any of these kind of processes. And all this is factored to make a design. Then you come to the, as I was mentioning, the gravity driven water pool, which is on top. This gravity driven water pool design is also a challenging task, as I mentioned, that if you have such a water body on top, how does it affect in a seismic condition? This is an important parameter of civil engineering design. Then comes the huge mess of the pipelines. How are they going to behave in a seismic loading condition? This is what is being shown there, that you have different type of layout. It can, you have some flexibility issue. You can have some what they call snubbers. That is the X plates which absorb the energy by hysteresis. You have many plastic, elastoplastic behavior of those kind of components which are located here, and they will absorb energy in the seismic condition. And then finally, after all this, you come to this layout 4, which is optimized in the flexibility and simple, and also uses X plates for the elastoplastic deformation. Now I come to some of the things like, see, containment design. Okay, you have design. Again, the question comes, this is an experiment, this is a 1/4 scale. So we build a whole building, 1/4 scale, internally pressurize, and allow it to burst. This is being done in Tarapur, already it is there. And you have a large number of strain gauges embedded in the system so that you can actually understand the deformation behavior of a whole building. So you need to validate each of these, what has been designed, through experiments. You have to validate the fuel assembly, because it's a very interesting type of a fuel design. Here you have the fuel, as I said, that this is the outer periphery is thorium plutonium MOX, and inside you have thorium uranium 233 MOX. But just at the core, there's a water pipe tube, and we call it water rod, because this is solid water, solid in the sense, not solid in the phase, but there's no void. And in case of any problem, any thermal excursion of the fuel, this will start sprinkling water there, not only for cooling, but also as a, this will also quench the neutronic process there, because water is a good absorber. So in this process, as you know, that 19 element, this is our present generation 220 megawatt reactor configuration, and this is what is evolved now, 54 element 300 megawatt composite cluster of advanced heavy water reactor. And now we know that we have achieved all those design parameters as I originally mentioned. There is a very interesting application of this new novel design. So far I have been talking of the Indian context, where we are trying to convert thorium to uranium 233 and then all the same time getting energy. Here is a concept. You see, there is very large quantity of weapon grade plutonium in the world. And when you are using this weapon grade plutonium, you want to burn them out. Because after the strategic arms limitation treaty, both in US and in Russia, they have a compulsion of burning out a lot of plutonium. How do you burn plutonium? Again, plutonium burning cannot be done by chemical burning. It has to be done by nuclear burning. Now, we have now seen that this same design can be used for low enriched uranium instead of plutonium, and we can also have thorium, LEU with thorium. What we can do, this, if you have a thorium and uranium mix or thorium and plutonium mix, it is possible to burn plutonium deeply. Deep burning doesn't mean only deep in distance. Deep burning means that you can reduce the plutonium-239 content to a large extent so that it does not remain as a weapon grade plutonium. And that design feature is also meeting with this particular design of our HWR. This is only to show that the modern light water reactor can also be used. But look at the advantage. If you use advanced heavy water reactor, we can see that the fissile material is dropped down very, very significantly by the HWR design. Design validation requires experiment, and as I told you that we have to do each of this independently by experiments. This is the building housing the ITL, that is integral test loop. This is a full length, though, as I can show you the same thing. This is the vertical pressure tube and it is being cooled down, and you show that yes, it satisfies all your stipulated theoretical conditions. You do the parallel channel, as I was mentioning to you, that if you have multiple channels, do they take? And it's a very interesting way of looking at it, that there are oscillations found in the mixed mode, but we find that the void reactivity feedback is totally simulated, and we find that there is a natural tendency. It doesn't go really out of phase. If it goes really out of phase, then there's a danger, but that doesn't happen in nature. Then passive containment cooling. How is the outer containment cooled? That also is experimentally proved. Major experimental facility, the 3 MW boiling water loop. This also does all that which is being done by theoretical. Then we have a critical facility where we can study the neutronics, and that is what is all being done for different configuration, where we can actually change the pitch of these the fuel pins and come and see that where exactly the optimum combination comes. We are also doing a large HWR test facility at Tarapur, where we have even the fueling machine, full size fueling machine is getting tested. Structural safety. We have to see that the leak before break kind of a criteria is fulfilled. Fatigue investigations on this, and there again we see that how exactly the fatigue behavior of the pressure tube as well as other steel structures are qualified. Then the ratcheting. Ratcheting is a kind of a, if you have a bent tube inside pressurized and you have a seismic load, it will get a loading which is called ratcheting, typically like this. You know, in the Structural Engineering Research Institute in Chennai, we have a facility where we can really do the full size, the pipes internally pressurized, given a stress, and you can see the pattern to see the stress strain behavior, so you understand the entire system, how it behaves, the full size ones. You do some testing in a shake table, that's also there in SERC Chennai. So you again try to prove that experimentally. So like that, you develop everything. This is the thing, we want 100 years of life. That means you have to have the welding, which is called narrow gap welding. You cannot allow that older system welding. And the narrow gap welding, and how does it behave under different stresses, that's also being done experimentally. There are many technology development. If you have this is the header, and from there the downcomer comes. Now, this is a high pressure component. In a high pressure component, if you have the downcomer directly welded here, then there's a problem, because you are having a high pressure system in which in the vessel itself you are doing welding. So instead you have a pull out technology. This is how the pull out is done. And after pull out, you have the welding, but they have the welding outside. And that's an advantage. This is also a technology development. You have to develop pressure tube, which has a gradient in the thickness as well as in diameter. This allows it to be taken out and replaceable pressure tube. So to summarize, I can say that just to give you a flavor, when you talk of a design, the design includes all these features. It is not just design on the paper. It's a design which takes into account all eventualities. It's a design which is also completely supported by experimental validation. And then only we say that we have and it also satisfies our basic design objectives. That is, in this case, the system should be such that we'll be able to convert the thorium to uranium-233, and eventually this will be a major energy supplier for our country in the future. I'll stop here, but if you have any questions, I'm ready to answer.
any question is okay.
Okay. Is there an estimate? Is there an estimate? I'm sure there would be of the economic implications of these extra teachers. How does it add to power?
Yes. Not very accurate today. Today we cannot say that this AHWR design will be able to compete with a standardized light water reactor design. Neither it will be competing. Main reason is that if you take the per megawatt ton of concrete used, it's much larger, because you are talking of a very large volume also storing that water. So, but you know, safety has no price. So that is why I'm now saying that when we take into account the total safety feature of that, I think it qualifies, and that's why it has been grouped in the generation 3 plus design by International Atomic Energy Authority. And so we feel that it's a good candidate, but obviously it is costlier than the present the available light water reactors. Yes.
By you people, which makes you so proud. And if they're all in the class of about 200 to 300 megawatt energy development, electricity development, that means the total heat content will be something like 1,000 megawatt.
900 to 1,000.
About 900,000. We are comfortable in handling. We have the technology. I suddenly see in most of the regulations from the government that you are going for 1,650 megawatt electricity equivalent.
Yes.
1,000 megawatt electricity equivalent from Russia, where we don't know anything about their technology, and to the extent of having about 20 of those reactors coming to India, and the technology of even what we have as the French people establishing the new fourth generation reactors, they are also the ones who cannot be tested.
Okay.
In fact, the first one is to come up in Finland next year, that is in 2013 or 2012.
Yes.
Is it fair to ask whether we have the capability of taking that kind of exponentially rising risk? In these cases, you know the nuts, bolts, screws, everything.
Yes.
Do you know anything of these things at all? And is it fair? I mean, that you know means you are not charging the government that should be. But is this a wise thing to do when the world is going for smaller megawattage of the nuclear reactors, including liquid fluoride reactors, including something which is of the nature of 100, you know, the class of like, you know, SO-146 or whatever it is, the Russians are making. Is that fair at all?
Yeah. It's a very good question. The issue is that we are comfortable with pressurized heavy water reactor. Why we are going in for the light water reactor in a major way? You see, light water reactors have come to a kind of a maturity. In the world, if you see that the total number of nuclear power that is getting generated, over 85% is through light water reactor, and generally much larger size. Because as I told you earlier also, the reactor concept, it becomes a very simple, it's like a huge pressure vessel, very huge pressure vessel, and inside that pressure vessel, it is, I can compare it with a pressure cooker. See here, as I am telling that you, it's a very sophisticated design, no doubt, but much more complex. Whereas a simple light water reactor is a huge pressure vessel, you fit it inside the fuel, close the cap, bolt it up, and don't open it at all for a period of 18 months, now they're trying to do even for 24 months, and continuously draw power out of it. No interference, no nothing inside that, it continuously gives you power. It has been so standardized everywhere that it has really gone past that doubt which you are raising. You told about its untested reactor. Now I'll tell you that any reactor process or reactor development is nothing but an evolutionary process. The same reactor, the EPR which is being talked about, 1650, identical concept with a little less features of the safety, are already working in Germany, which are called convoy reactors, and a very large number of them are working in France. So it's only the extension of that to a larger capacity. There are two philosophies in this. One side you can say that you do it into smaller and smaller units. That's one type. But the smaller and smaller unit also does not reduce the probability of some accident, because it actually distributes more. You do it in a large capacity, it's not just economy. Economy, the probability of what is called core damage, all that gets substantially reduced. And EPR, what is being talked about, there are two types of reactors for which we have now more knowledge, because so far the American designs have not been reviewed by our system. We have actually reviewed the Russian reactors, VVER, which are working in fairly large number in many parts of the world. And this review we have been doing, the safety review we have started from the year 2000. Over 10 years, the complete review of this, and Kudankulam, the reactor which is coming out, 1000 megawatt, is of that type. Not only that, I have not discussed some things. You see, for the safety, everything is taken into account, even to the extent what is called core catcher. What is core catcher? In case that you have an excursion in heat and the entire core melts down. If it melts down, it's no longer a one metal. So that's why it's called corium. See, it's corium, it's a variety of metal melted down into a molten mass, and that can penetrate and can deposit somewhere to make another critical mass. Possible, no? Just conceptually. At least fiction writers will choose this kind of thing. So in fiction writing, this kind of possibility is there. So then, but we have to work against that also. What is done is a core catcher. Core catcher is something where that molten mass will get distributed and it will never be having an opportunity to come to a critical mass. So in case of VVER Kudankulam, we have adopted core catcher. We have adopted double containment. We have adopted passive cooling. It is much before Fukushima. Decision was made in 1998 or 88 first. So each of these parameters, so when you talk of a reactor safety feature, each of these is taken into account, and you have a means of allaying the fears. And on that basis you work out. Today we work out typically it's something like between 1 in million to 1 in 10 million kind of a probability. This is a PSA, probability safety analysis. So that is how it is being done. So it is not, I mean, obviously what you raise, those questions will also come in our mind, and we do that. And after the complete analysis, we are quite satisfied both for VVER and also for EPR. EPR, this untested technology has come out in, it's mostly newspaper. And I'll tell you one point on which it is untested, they're saying. See, most of these reactors, after building the whole thing, you are making inside layered by a stainless steel containment. Now, this stainless steel containment or stainless steel cladding of a concrete surface is being questioned, because this stainless steel cladding requires certain amount of, it's a manufacturing technology. What will be the kind of a weldment thickness, how it will be laid, and all this. In that, there has been some question that has been raised by the regulatory authority, with the French regulatory authority, for their system. And that's not that is not being answered, it's being answered. But it is that issue which has come. It is not a major issue in the reactor safety that is being raised in anywhere.
I understand. Areva has promised
that they will have Areva's promise we are not going to take. No. No question we can take any. Our regulatory mechanism is such that we have to first of all see that is it certified by your parent country? Number one. But then we forget about that. Now we have to do ab initio checking of the entire safety system ourselves, and only then we'll be able to take it. Now the question is that you are saying that in Finland, which will be coming in a year or so, it's got terribly delayed. The second one, actually it's got delayed only because of this safety clarifications. Second set is coming in Flamanville in France, third one in China, and then there are, by the time we get it in 2018 or 2019, there'll be several of them will be working in the world. It is not that we are going the first one. In fact, obviously there will be big difficulty for Indian system to accept something for the first time. Of course, if we do this also for the first time, HWR, which is our own design, we will be for the first time, no question. But when we are accepting somebody else's design, I'm sure that we are not going to take it up as a first model to come to ours. But there's a problem. Problem is that if you accept the older model, then people will say that you are now buying an outdated technology. If you want to buy a car, if you buy an older car, you know, that's the same psychology. So it's very difficult which way to go. Yes, please.
So recently there was this public statement released by lots of eminent people, including it was signed by our director, calling for a moratorium and also a review of the entire, you know, mechanism that's in place. I just wanted to get your response as, you know, somebody heading AEC, what you think about the call for the moratorium.
See, the word moratorium is a I'll give some examples. Obviously, you see, in reactor safety analysis, one of the factors which is always taken into account, what is the worldwide experience? You cannot say that we can claim that in India we have got something like 400 reactor year of experience and all that. We don't have a single major accident, excepting one fire accident which was there in Narora, that too in the turbine building. Actual in the reactor there has been no accident, all that we can say, but that is not enough. In nuclear reactor technology, you have to say what is worldwide. Worldwide, what is the scenario of safety? So it is just 25 years of Chernobyl is over. Okay, 25 years of Chernobyl, and imagine that had that Fukushima had not happened. Imagine that scenario. Obviously, one would have taken credit that, okay, 25 years have passed. You now see that the reactor safety has improved so much. Now we can, I could have said much stronger. Today Fukushima has happened, and once Fukushima has happened, that experience or that learning lesson is definitely there. Then the question comes that where would lead to? In fact, it can go to a second talk. If you are prepared, I can give it. But I have actually material just after this. Yeah. So no. The answer is, you have asked what is moratorium. So there are different countries which are responding in different ways. China says that we will moratorium. What is the moratorium meaning? They have 70,000 megawatt plant capacity by 2020. 70,000 megawatt plant capacity by 2020. So what they'll do, they say that beyond that, when something to be considered, we'll have a rethink. What is the rethink in Russia? You have again seen the statement. In Russian statement is that they are not disturbing their projected plan as it is. You come to England, which has actually stopped the reactor making from way back. They don't have anything today. And again, they are going back. They say that there is no other alternative but to go for nuclear energy. And they are going ahead. So India, today what we have gone, I haven't got a government clearance to say that there is the plan as usual will go. No. What we have seen only recently, that at least in the Jaitapur, the government has declared that yes, Jaitapur project will go on. The other projects, but before anything, the issue is coming is that we have to make a complete analysis. And it's a whole world body is very conscious about it. So there will be a tremendous amount of exchange of information that what has happened in Fukushima, what, you see, in Fukushima, one thing is also true, a Richter, yes. Yes, the position, if I say in one word, the atomic energy position says that we will continue, but not continue as is. Are you a journalist? No. You are asking like that. The answers, many questions cannot be answered in just yes or no answer. You need to explain. If you are a journalist and you want a headline, then I can give you that kind of an answer. But no science is done in a journalism way. So there are differences of that. So I'm seeing, that's why I'm giving this answer. I have to qualify my answer. Answer to be qualified, that all that experience gained in an event, threadbare, will be seen, discussed, and seen what is the repercussion of that. See, the first point I'll tell you, that in Fukushima, there is no passive cooling system. And you have no passive cooling system, immediately the temperature, I have a few slides to just show you. In fact, I can show you just after the lecture. So what we are doing in case of our system, we already have. Between 2004 and 2006, there has been a very serious safety review of Tarapur 1-2. On the basis of that, there are several things which have been added. We have a safety, which have a passive cooling system. What are the things to be augmented? We augment that. So my answer is not that okay, we go as usual. No, we have to take into account what has happened in Fukushima and do the preventive actions in all our reactors, not just in Tarapur. And again, go to the regulatory board, get it qualified, and then run. That is how we'll do. Future program, as has been pointed out earlier, that if you have to have any new reactor, so we have to go through the same testing that has to be done, say in case of wherever Fukushima has happened, that situation, and then see that this qualifies for such situations or not. That is how we have to do.
Seismic status of our country is in developing stage. So how this nuclear reactor design as well as component will be experimentally evaluated for the future seismicity?
Future seismicity?
Yeah.
No, it is in, it was seismic design we have been doing from the very beginning. It is only in nuclear industry which picked up this. The whole seismic design, not just for the building equipment, everything has been done in nuclear industry for the first time, and the maturity that has come in the seismic design, we are totally confident on seismic design. Yes. Okay, I'll answer one by one. Atomic energy plants are not necessarily made in the coastal region. In fact, today also if you see, it is there in Rajasthan, which is not in the coast, Naroda, which is not in the coast. There are only few in the coast, most of them. Now what we have decided, that we'll be having our pressurized heavy water reactor system will be inland. They will not be in the coast. Now why? Because when we are talking of this large size plant, what you mentioned, 1000 megawatt plus, the pressure vessel itself is a mammoth object. It cannot be taken by the rail or road routes. So it has to be only brought by sea, and then you can position. This is one reason. Second reason is that you need to have a very large inventory of water nearby, a large heat sink. Not for normal operation. Normal operation you don't, but you need a large heat sink. So you need a large water body nearby, and that is why the second reason. Third reason is that when you have a nuclear power station, we have in our country a stipulation that 1.6 kilometer, now on some cases they can reduce it, exclusion zone. If you have a nuclear reactor here, around that 1.6 kilometer, there cannot be any human habitation. Now if you want to do that first of all, large water body is not there, then you have to draw a full circle. If you are doing it in the coast, you have to draw a semicircle. See the space advantage? So these are the three basic points why you need you follow. This logic is as simple as that. These are the reasons why we have to do that in the coastal region.
Okay, sir,
now you will ask the second question, yeah. Thermal ecology. That if you put all that heat into the sea, all the fish will die. We have seen in newspaper headings that you can make a reactor, but the Arabian Sea will be lost. It is not so. Arabian Sea will not be lost. So that, how do I prove that? The proving that, actually, the one very important study was initiated, not today, not because of Fukushima. You think that Fukushima only has woken us up?
No, not
so
actually.
So it was done from the time.
The question was there from long time, as I said.
I'll tell you. So there is a study initiated in 2000, done by 8 independent universities to see the effect of thermal ecology. Because there was a parameter which came up that where you have a water discharge, there will be a temperature rise, obviously. Now, if there's a temperature rise, what is the maximum level of temperature rise that you can tolerate? You means not me, fishes and microorganisms. So in that area, so then the issue was done. This has to be done in different seasons. So over a 5-year period, at 2-month interval, the entire bioorganism study in these areas have been done in different ways. And then we have established that we can allow maximum rise in temperature in that mixing zone, not everywhere, only in the mixing zone, to 7 degrees Celsius. That's the maximum upper limit. So to design your cooling system and also your discharge system in such a manner, the temperature does not go beyond 7 degrees. Now, what is the actual number? In case of Jaitapur, it has been, the actual number is the water will not be discharged directly into the sea at the coast. You have an undersea tunnel through which water will go to a distance between 1.5 to 2.5 kilometer into the sea, and there you have a sparger. Through that, water will be distributed in a mixing zone. And in that mixing zone, in the two worst months of the summer, the temperature rise will be maximum of 4.5 degrees Celsius. So we have taken care of that. In the coast, right at the coast, the water temperature rise will be 0.5 degrees Celsius. So we know that this is the thermal ecology issue. So I can assure you that without losing Arabian Sea, you can give you power.
Sir, okay. One, as I told, one second one
I
is...
I thought I have answered two questions.
No, no. Sir, the safety issues are very critical, that's
yes.
true. But it is critical for other kind of power plants, or let's say they can also suffer that isolation and everything.
Everywhere, but it's not
steel
done.
Plants. So why it is so critical for atomic, means radio, is it because of the radioactive issues?
Yes. The point is that this is, let me face it. Everybody will say that if you have an accident in other arena, then what will be its consequence? Consequence is something what you see immediate. In case of atomic energy, you can see that the consequences are not going to be only immediate, it will also have long term. But again, this is highly exaggerated. I'll just give you one example to, you know, Chernobyl, we think that thousands of people have got, you know, the real number due to the radiation, there has been a fatality of 30 people. So it's not a very large number, but how many people got affected by the cancer of the, thyroid cancer. Thyroid cancer number is actually 1,000 plus. But 95% of that is recovered. So the issue is that thyroid cancer, if you say in whole of Ukraine, Belarus, you see the total thyroid cases, this kind of a number is coming. And if any case in Ukraine or Belarus thyroid cancer comes, they'll immediately associate it is because of Chernobyl. Which if you even if you accept that, the cases of recovery is very large. It's really 95%. I'm not quoting, I am quoting from Badway, who is the director of TMC, who has done a very detailed study on this. So the in effect, the number of casualty is not as large as we imagine. But can I deny the fact that some of the radioactivity will survive for several thousand years? I can't. So it is important, not only important, it's extremely important to see the safety. So it's not like in other areas. Here you have to be very particular. See, in fact, I can show you. I just, since you all are asking questions, so please pardon me. Because this you will not get easily in when newspapers won't print it. You see, this is how actually the Fukushima reactor, I'll show you that exactly what has happened. This is the reactor, this is the pressure vessel. And this is called the containment. This bottle shaped one, this is a containment, it's a concrete vessel. And as I told you, the straightway steam goes out. And it comes back like this in the cold water. It is. So now, why Fukushima? What is Fukushima accident actually? Fukushima accident is nothing but, this is how it is. Normally, the core is submerged in water and steam is here. This blue part is water and continuously being cooled. But what happens? You have the coolant. These pumps are no longer operating. If pumps don't operate, the coolant will not flow. What happens? This water level will go down like this. So you have some part of the fuel which is exposed to the environment here, which is steam environment. What is this made up of? It is made up of zirconium alloy tubes. Inside that you have uranium oxide, enriched uranium oxide. This zirconium will react with steam. Zirconium and water reacts with zirconium oxide and hydrogen. So this starts producing hydrogen. So now this pressure vessel is filled up not with steam alone, but steam plus hydrogen. It's filling up like that. So that extra energy can be deposited into a torus. There's a torus like this in this mechanism, which is already there. But that also fills up with hydrogen. Once it fills up with hydrogen, pressure builds up, it leaks into the outer chamber. So this inner containment is also filled up with now hydrogen plus steam. It becomes so much that it releases into this. As long as it is hydrogen inside this, there's no problem. There's no oxygen there. But it releases into the outside reactor building. There hydrogen mixes with the atmospheric oxygen. And it makes into a kind of an explosive mixture, and that bursts open. And then you find that this is what you have seen in TV, that something blasts. And then you see that, you imagine there's something like a nuclear bomb has blasted inside. It's not that. It is nothing but that hydrogen burning into. There are problems. This hydrogen is also carrying in case there's reaction product and that has some radioactivity, it goes with that. So I'm not undermining the difficulty, undermining the problem. It's a very severe problem. But you don't compare it with a, say there are headlines, Fukushima versus Hiroshima. So that is wrong. It is not Hiroshima. It is not even Chernobyl. It is something different. Yes, it had contained radioactivity, and that radioactivity release has caused, similar thing has happened here in the dry well. This is how it, you saw this picture, no? This is how it used to be looking now. But inside that you can see the containment is still alive as it is. It's only the outer, this building which exploded because hydrogen mixes with water. So all the four accidents there, four explosions are hydrogen explosions. You have the variation in different cesium-137. Cesium-137, you know, is a very complex thing. Cesium-137 deposition happens on vegetation. And cesium-137 has a reasonably long life. So what happens through vegetation, it goes into the food chain, human food chain also, animal food chain and human food chain. So these are the serious issues. So I'm not saying that you undermine the seriousness of this. I'm only saying that there is exaggeration. So there is, if you compare Chernobyl and Fukushima, it is like that, and there are many things. So the problem is that this is how the different countries are doing on the major nuclear power generating station. And in fact, Japan also has made a statement that if they have to rebuild their country, what they'll do? What's the alternative? If you have an alternative, we must use that alternative, but there's no such alternative. So what you have been telling, I think, main issue is that we have a huge gap. See, today 40% of the people in our country do not have any electricity. No electricity at all. Our per capita consumption is 700 kilowatt hour as against 2500 kilowatt hour for the world average. World average. So we are worse than even sub-Saharan Africa in electricity production. 700, close to 700. So in over the period, you know, this kind of a deficit will be there. And this deficit definitely can be filled up by burning coal. You'll be producing 4.7 billion ton of coal, four times of US present consumption. So will you not raise a voice on that? That because so much of CO2 will be generated. So we have to have find some alternative. And that is why is the plan. And plan is, again, your answer. See, this is the Indian country. If we do our own three stage, we are in minuscule. That, can you see that magenta line here? Some very thin line is there. That's the present position. This, by purely indigenous effort, can grow like this, provided the fast reactor program is successful. Three-stage program is successful, we can grow like that. But like in France, they woke up when the oil crisis came in 70s. So they have now made, along with they, France does not have any uranium in their soil. What they have done, they had this reactor, 85% of power they are producing by nuclear. In addition, they got this uranium from outside and they have the holding of the mines all over the world. Today, the uranium that they have already got into their country is now resulting into plutonium, and that will survive them for 100 years. So imagine, because if you import some uranium from uranium-235, that associated U-238 gives you plutonium. So that is what, that gap will be filled up if we import a little bit. We don't want to import much. We want to import only a little bit and then have our own light water reactors, Indian light water reactors, to survive, which, as you said, could not, need not be 1650. It can be 700, 2000. So that's our game plan. We have to do it, no? Okay, thank you.
I think we should close.
Yes, we should close, otherwise it goes on.
It is a quite long time. So we will all agree that we have a very enlightening lecture and equally enlightening discussions, post-lecture discussions, and we must thank Sukumar Banerjee for giving such a beautiful Before I give a final vote of thanks, I request our director to come in the stage, Professor Ballan, and give some mementos.
Oh. You know, if I give this to you,
I can come on.
I just 1 minute, I'll be very brief, vote of thanks, but I must say this, that Mrs. Ramsheshan is here with us. Ma'am, thank you very much to be here for this lecture. And I must thank Professor Banerjee. Dr. Banerjee is extremely busy schedule, but in spite of that busy schedule, he came here and delivered the lecture. And all the people who are behind organizing this, and all of you, of course, so that this was an exciting occasion. There's a tea there, and please join for the tea.